I can say what I thought was probably not something I should say, and that is that Tom would not, if he were here, he would say, I'd like to thank everybody who made this morning possible, but I don't think I should say it, so forget it. Over the course of his career, Tom had the opportunity to work in many places and with a great number of talented, good people. But TC always held a special place in his heart. It was here that he received his doctorate. Later, it was here that he worked alongside the top scholars and thinkers on the issues of the day, all of whom he admired. It was here that he worked with students who challenged him, energized him, helped to keep his gaze steadily fixed on the promise of the future. So it is with great appreciation that we are gathered at TC this morning. President Susan Fuhrman, someone Tom held in such high esteem, has kindly opened the doors to us, and I am so pleased that she is here with us to celebrate. President Fuhrman.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to Teachers College. Today, we celebrate the beautiful life of a truly remarkable man, a great educator, leader, and friend for all seasons. Tom Sobol, Harriet, we're so honored you chose to hold this gathering at TC. As much as Tom loved Teachers College, the TC community loved Tom back even more, so thank you. Today we'll hear an amazing assortment of people speak about the Tom Sobol they knew and admired so deeply. They'll describe his many acts of professional and personal courage and compassion. I'll try to give you a little bit more context for why Tom Sobol means so much to us at TC. And to do that, I'm going to focus on three simple words that tell us much about Tom: accountability, humanism, and courage. The first word, alas, has come to mean something quite different from what Tom understood it to be. In both his private and public life, Tom quite simply set the standard for accountability. Through his teaching and the way he conducted himself at all times, Tom showed how we can all seek to act morally, not in the sense of adherence to some external doctrine, but by looking within to discover what it is we believe and then using what we discover to guide us in all that we do. Tom did that as superintendent of Scarsdale Schools when he went out of his way to bring a fierce opponent into a budget review meeting. He did it as commissioner when, over the warnings of his staff, he released an internal report that took New York State to task for failing to provide equal educational opportunity to poor and disadvantaged students. And he did it again when he took up the cause of plaintiffs who were suing the state for more money for New York City schools. That kind of accountability is not generally associated with most public officials today, but Tom was no typical public official. He went into public life because, above all, he truly cared about doing good for others. Again and again, he took heat, as the saying goes, from many different constituents. Yet ultimately, no one was tougher on Tom Sobol than Tom Sobol himself. In reviewing his own actions, even when others lavished praise on him, he was brutally honest in parsing his own motivations or pointing out where he felt he had come up short. In a TC course he taught on ethics and education law, Tom asked his students to subject themselves to that same kind of scrutiny. He didn't preach a particular moral vision, but rather insisted that each and every student conduct the necessary soul searching to arrive at a guiding moral vision of their own. His passionate approach to learning and living brings me to the second word that describes Tom and why he was so loved and respected: his embrace of humanism. Tom was a musician, an athlete, an elegant writer, and a voracious reader, who was fond of quoting Robert Frost, E.M. Forster, and Mae Sarton. He believed that education should make each of us well-rounded and passionately engaged with life. Indeed, that living a moral life was essential to being a well-rounded human being. Becoming moral, in my view, is the opposite of restraint and detachment, Tom said in 2006 when he was honored at TC's commencement. It requires passionate engagement with other humans and losing oneself in something larger than oneself before the self can be defined. So Tom believed in personal accountability. He believed in a humanistic vision of education. And the third word that describes why Tom was such a hero to so many of us is courage, truly inspiring courage. He demonstrated this courage throughout his life, but especially in the last few years. Supported by Harriet, his remarkable wife, and by colleagues and friends who loved him dearly, he never gave in to the paralyzing illness that confined him first to a wheelchair and then to his bed. 3 years ago, he published a memoir, wonderfully titled My Life in School, which he literally typed with one finger. That fact becomes all the more astonishing when you lose yourself in his prose, which flows beautifully and effortlessly off the page. I'd like to share a passage, Tom's description of a creek near his grandmother's house from when he was a little boy. To this day, I can remember standing precariously on the outside edge of the railing, peering beyond the marsh grass into the distance, striving to understand what was happening. I would throw small sticks into the water and wait until they were lifted by the incoming tide. They stopped, wavered for a long moment, and then were carried outward through the tall marsh grasses toward the sea, where they disappeared from view. The back and forth of the water made a great impact on me. Later, grown-ups would explain about the moon and the tides, and I would try to get all that into my head. But all I really knew was that something very wonderful was happening, and I felt a part of it. Tom approached the world with the same delight that he viewed the mystery of the tides, and he believed that inspiring such delight and curiosity was what education was all about. Tom, while you taught here at TC, all of us, too, felt that something very wonderful was happening and that we were very, very fortunate indeed to be part of it. Thank you.
Good morning. In 2001, two TC professors, Thomas Sobol and Gibran Mardalani, employed me as their assistant. They put their trust in me and, in consequence, changed my professional life. Working with Tom for 6 years was an amazing experience, fun, and a chance that I will always be grateful for. It grounded me at TC, where I continue to work. Thank you, Harriet, for inviting me and for asking me to read a poem at Tom's memorial service. Tom knew so much about art, and he often used poetry in his class and for his lectures. I know because I sat at his class and went to all his lectures during those years. He appreciated quality and was always open to unusual perspectives. I hope he would like the poem that I chose. It was written by a Polish poet, the Nobel Prize winner in 1996. In literature, Wisława Szymborska, and was translated by my very dear friend, a professor at Radford University, Jolanta Wawrzycka. Cat in the empty apartment. To die, one does not do that to a cat. For what is a cat to do in an empty apartment? Climb the walls, brush against the furniture. Seemingly nothing is changed, but there are changes. Seemingly nothing is moved, but things are moved apart and the lamp is dark in the evenings. Steps are heard in the stairway, but not those. Hand that puts fish in the saucer, also not the one it used to be. Something here does not start at the routine time. Something here is not happening as it should. Someone was and was here, but then suddenly vanished and is stubbornly absent. All the closets have been checked, the shelves run through, the carpet crawled under to see. Even the bin was broken and papers got scattered. What else is there to do? Sleep and wait. Well, just let him come back. Just let him show up. Then he will find out that one can't do that to a cat. He will be approached nonchalantly, just so, and hurriedly, on some very upset pose. And no jumping, no squealing at first. Thank you.
First, I would like to thank Harriet for the honor of being a part of today's tribute to Tom. Tom Sobol was a Renaissance man, equally conversant with the prose of Yogi Berra and the plays of Shakespeare. Regal in stature, humble in deportment, he was in service to all children, from those in high-achieving suburban schools to those in the urban inner cities. A true teacher and a scholar and statesman as well, with a deep commitment to high-quality public education, he championed equal opportunity for all. What follows is a personal story because it exemplifies many of Tom's characteristics, among them, risk-taker and coach. It also illustrates Tom's understanding of people and the organization in which they live and work. He was, after all, an insightful and inspirational leader. In 1983, Dr. Thomas Sobol and the Board of Education, headed by Board President Joan Mark, took a chance on a neophyte and hired me as Director of Personnel. I remember to this day the telephone call and the question, "What are you doing these days?" in those stentorian tones. In fact, I was just coming off the Harrison Board of Education and completing my doctoral work at Teachers College, which was a case study of board and superintendent relationships. Tom said he had a position as director of personnel with a small salary, so we arranged to meet, interview, and during the course of the conversation, he said there were three major requirements: a successful endorsement from the board, the ability to work with the personnel secretary, the gatekeeper of the office, who managed by intimidation, and if I could jump that second high hurdle, I had to pass muster with the president of the Scarsdale Teachers Association, Judy Schwartz. Somehow I got past those three obstacles at the gate and thus began my career in Scarsdale and my long-standing friendship with Harriet and Tom. Several years ago, I wrote a note to Tom that I would like to share with you. "Dear Tom, this is a thank you note. Thank you for the opportunity to work for the best in the business. Thank you for being the quintessential educator. Thank you for the mentorship and the leading by example. Thank you for the best job I ever had and the faith you had in a novice. Thank you for the excitement and the challenge of working in that mythical place, Scarsdale. Thank you for the intellectual engagement, the ability to make us feel that ideas could take flight and we were part of a magical place. Thank you, too, for that initial gift of my secretary. As you know, you told me the job was mine if I could manage to cross her desk each morning and survive. Thank you for making sure I completed my doctorate and giving me those first summer months to do so. 30 years ago, you said, 'What are they reading at Teachers College?' And 30 years later, you were telling them what to read at TC. And 40 years later, in my classroom, I am telling students to read your book, My Life in School. Thank you for the years of fun and friendship with you and Harriet, for the Albany experience, for the unique opportunity of sleeping in the commissioner's bedroom closet, the only air-conditioned space available in that 28-room mansion. And thank you for Jenny Shakespeare in the Park and for the joy of seeing those young actors hone their craft around the kitchen table. And thank you and Harriet for the fabulous trip to Europe, the cruises and the excursion, the trip to Normandy and St. Mary-Église and the charming French Inn. Thank you for the invitation to England as you were learning about Her Majesty's Inspectorate. If only your predecessors followed in your footsteps. Thank you to you and Harriet for the board parties and the celebrations, for the friendship, especially the celebration of Harriet's 50th. I remember the menu and the cake that you planned so meticulously. Thank you for the friendship that allowed me to come to know and appreciate the important role Harriet has played in every facet of your life. Thank you for giving the state and the nation the leadership, wisdom, and vision for combining them with applied, practical applications. And thank you for the unparalleled balance and intelligence you displayed as commissioner, and for the critical initiatives necessary to improve the quality of education in the state and beyond. Thank you, Tom, for embodying the spirit of Professor Maxine Green, for you saw things as they might otherwise be, and you tried to make them so. And finally, thank you, Tom, for the very essence of yourself, for your wit and wisdom, your courage and conviction, your generosity of spirit for all that you are. To quote your favorite philosopher, Yogi, it ain't over till it's over. And for us, it will never be over, as your legacy lives in all of us who are here today. We love you more than we can ever say. And Harriet, we would like to present you with a collection of memories and anecdotes from members of the Scarsdale staff with whom Tom worked. And I will give you this as I come down. Thank you.
Good morning. Thomas Sobol. No middle initial. And I had his signature down perfectly. Good morning. I was fortunate enough to be Dr. Sobol's secretary when he was the New York State Commissioner of Education and President of the University of New York. He'd always say to me, oh, that is such a long title. Cut it. As commissioner, Dr. Sobol had many important matters for all New York children. He understood what it meant to educate a child, the importance of it, the challenge of it, and the courage that it took to do what was best for the child. But I'd like to speak today about Dr. Sobol, my boss and my friend. Smart, funny, warm, and engaging, very perceptive. He saw the humor in things most of the time, and he always kept things in perspective. 1986 was the beginning of a lasting friendship and respect for both Dr. Sobol and Mrs. Sobol. Before starting in Albany, he visited the State Education Building after hours just to walk around without anybody knowing who he was. He told me that guaranteed him getting a clean read on everybody. In my interview with him, he said that he had already interviewed me that night. He commuted from Scarsdale to Albany and back each week because home was Scarsdale. Not the commissioner's residence. My gracious, that was too big, too stuffy, and not his style at all. I remember bringing work to him at the residence, and instead of going into the formal dining room, I would be invited to the back kitchen for tea, toast, and jam. He and Mrs. Sobol were always a team. Often he would stop during the workday and he'd call Mrs. Sobol to tell her some little interesting fact or a piece of information that he thought she would find interesting. All five of us in the commissioner's office were family. He took a personal interest in each of our lives. We all helped with Axter Shakespeare Company, the fundraisers, and we attended all of their performances in Washington Park. Such fun we had. My daughter Bridget held the Bible when Dr. Sobol was inaugurated. They attended Bridget's wedding and my second marriage. Holidays at the department were exciting. Dr. Sobol started a great tradition of decorating the columns of the dignified Commissioner's Row. We had scenes of Santa Claus, Hanukkah, Kwanzaa, Nativity, Frosty the Snowman, and the like. It was such a morale booster, and it extended his family arm to the whole department. We had our moments, but he always kept things in perspective. Often he would feel frustrated, and he would express that frustration to me. He'd raise his voice, he'd make his point, raise his voice a little higher, and then he'd look at me and he'd say, "Kate, you know I'm yelling at you. I'm not yelling at you, right?" It was very therapeutic for him, and it was actually comical to me. I never felt that he was yelling at me. But every time that happened, we would assure each other that that's what was going on. There was one day when everything that could go wrong did go wrong. And as we commiserated about it, Dr. Sobol wrote on his calendar, "Worst day ever." As we were preparing a report to the regents, he came across that note, and we both couldn't remember what it was that made that day the worst day. He turned to me and he said, "Now that puts things in perspective, doesn't it?" He was as lighthearted as often as possible. Some nights, whoever left the office would break out into song by that famous hit by Lawrence Welk, "Good Night, Ladies, Good Night, Gentlemen," much to the dismay of those passing by. Preparing for a trip to England, we were trying to schedule a time for him to check into the office. I was completely turned around trying to figure out the time difference between England and Albany. The more confused I got, the more delighted he became. And after all of that, he never called. He was very approachable. Dr. Sobol knew the building guards and the cleaning staff by name. I observed how he empowered people. Dr. Sobol encouraged the first ever Secretaries Summit. Now that's secretaries with a small s, the ones who typed letters and stayed in the office. At that summit, he was our keynote speaker, and every secretary walked a little taller after he spoke. He made every employee feel that they were a part of and important to the bigger mission. That was a gift that he had. He brought the best out in our staff. On the last day of his tenure, he gave each one of us in the office a personal letter. It was several pages long. It wasn't a token paragraph of thanks for everything. And he didn't regurgitate his state accomplishments. But he thanked us. And he shared his personal memories of our years together. Because he said that we were important to him. How kind and thoughtful that was. But that was Dr. Sobol. Dr. Sobol, using your own words, "I thank you for your service and your leadership. We were touched by your loving spirit and your useful hand." And Mrs. Sobol, Tommy, Sandy, Michael, Jenny, and Jeffrey, thank you for sharing him with us.
Good morning. In an exchange between Alexander Hamilton and Aaron Burr, Hamilton asks and answers his own question, "What is a legacy? It is seeds planted in a garden that you do not get to see grow. And so I offered for you several seeds sown by our colleague, Tom Sobol." And I'm going to do it in the format that I know Tom would enjoy because he had a wicked sense of humor. Jimmy Fallon's thank you notes. Thank you, Tom, for teaching and learning a perspective that you offered to us. Thank you for bringing me into the New Standards Project, which set out to design complex performance tasks that more closely resembled real-world problems, thereby providing a rich context in which students could demonstrate their knowledge and skills in real-world situations. There are schools today that are achieving success with this model. He supported them, he made sure they were protected, and he understood that if he watched over them, even from this place, they would continue to grow. The Performance Consortium of Schools owes Tom a deep debt of gratitude. He supported their performance-based system of assessment because it promoted the core values he believed in: teacher professionalism, student ownership of work, depth over courage, and inquiry-based learning. Now, expanding this seed that Tom has sown would allow many more schools to, guess what, opt in to a saner, more respectful, and professionally effective way of assessing learning. It would be a fitting tribute to his outstanding contribution to New York State public education. Thank you, Tom, for your perspective on governance. Tom was committed to a top-down support for bottom-up reform strategy, as unusual then as it is now. Tom understood the top-down support for bottom-up reform strategy marries the need for direction with the need for freedom and creativity implementation. He also recognized, as the commissioner, the state's influence was more likely to achieve its intended effect if it tells people what to achieve instead of telling them how to achieve it. We call that his compact for learning. Moreover, when a state imposes regulations from the top, in our state, people tend to resist the regulations. Doesn't matter what they say, partially because regulations don't fit local circumstances, but partially because New Yorkers really don't like being regulated. Thank you, Tom, for your commitment to social justice. These are Tom's words. I do not see why some children have to go to school in leaky buildings with broken toilets, no preschool, old textbooks, inadequately prepared teachers. My children did not. Maybe yours didn't. So why do some children find themselves in that environment? Tom said, in a democratic society, all children are to receive the education that is their birthright, not their birth conditions experience. And most importantly, in summary, thank you, Tom, for your principles of democracy. And these are Tom's words. Schools have never been about passing a standardized test. That's defining education much too narrowly. While he did not mean to diminish the centrality of academic competency, but it is the application of this knowledge to life settings that is the real measure of competence. From the beginning, our schools have been about character as well as competence, about wisdom as well as knowledge, about democracy as well as individual achievement. Schools are places where young people come together to learn, and it turns out that the coming together is as important as the learning. Or rather, the coming together enables a different kind of learning, the kind of learning that has to do with getting along with others, with learning how to be a member of a group, with a sense of identity, and a personal awareness that one is part of a society and a human condition vastly larger than oneself. Tom would say we ignore these principles at our peril. Harriet, those of us in the audience today are prepared to protect and nurture Tom's legacy seeds. Thank you.
Good morning. Dear Harriet, Sandy, Tommy, Michael, Walter, Jeff, Jenny, all the Sobols, families, and friends of Tom. I would like to start my tribute with a welcoming word Tom had used on few occasions while greeting his audience. He would say jokingly, "So good to see most of you." Well, so good to see most of you. Tom, with his heart of gold, was so engaging and true to his words, to his lofty soul. I send a warm and sincere salutation. We miss you a lot, Tom. We miss the man of vision, compassion, and principle. I was fortunate to work with Tom for 12 years. He was a man who preached and practiced his faith in public education and in helping the unprivileged. His name, Tom Sobol, will always be etched with radiant light in the hall of great educators. Tom admired Khalil Gibran, and I recall when he and Harriet had a wedding reception for me and my beloved wife, Gosha, in their house in Scarsdale. There, he read a passage from the prophet. So as a tribute to him, I'm reading a short passage from that spiritually inspiring book. Quote, "Then Almitara spoke, saying, 'We would ask now of death.' And Al-Mustafa said, 'You would know the secret of death, but how shall you find it unless you seek it in the heart of life? The owl, whose night-bound eyes are blind unto the day, cannot unveil the mystery of life. If you would indeed behold the spirit of death, open your heart wide unto the body of life. For life and death are one, even as the river and the sea are one. In the depth of your hopes and desires lies your silent knowledge of the beyond. And like seeds dreaming beneath the snow, your heart dreams of spring. Trust the dreams, for in them is hidden the great gate of eternity. For what is to die but to stand naked in the wind and to melt into the sun? What is to cease breathing but to free the breath from its restless tides, that it may rise and expand and seek God unencumbered? Only when you drink from the river of silence shall you indeed sing. And when you have reached the mountaintop, then you shall begin to climb. And when the earth shall claim your limbs, then shall you truly dance." End of quote. Well, in that spirit, I'm happy and privileged to announce that our friends at the Daesh Museum of Art, that jewel box of a museum in our proud city, have informed me that they earmarked $10,000 of funds in memory of Tom Sobol to be donated to students who would work with the museum in pursuing and promoting Tom's vision in excellence in education, in the field of educational practice. So thank you, Mrs. Amira Zahid, trustee of the museum, for this gift of recognition. Tom would definitely be delighted for that. When he shall die, take him and cut him out into stars, and he shall make the face of heaven so fine. Love you, Tom. Nobol Sobol. Thank you.
Good morning. Susan Fuhrman mentioned Tom's involvement in a lawsuit that challenged the inequities in funding for students in the state of New York. And I was the attorney who brought that case, and actually first got to know Tom Sobol as an adversary, because when you bring a case against the state, you sue everybody in sight who had any responsibility for the system that you're complaining about. So he was the commissioner of education, and we sued the governor, we sued the legislative leaders, and we sued Tom Sobol. as he recounted to me later, when he got these papers, he got very agitated, very upset, and he said to his attorney, this isn't fair. Literally half the material that they are quoting in their legal papers about how inequitable the system is, especially to poor and minority children, they're quoting from documents I've written or that I got the State Education Department to do research about. How can they put me on the defensive here and blame me for all of this? So the next day, the attorney gave me a call, and she said, Commissioner Sobel's very upset. He thinks you unfairly joined him as a defendant here. And I said, well, no problem. You know, under the procedural rules in New York State, a party to a litigation who thinks he's on the wrong side can make a motion to switch sides. And if Dr. Sobel would like to do that, we would support that motion. Well, again, I wasn't in the room, but as Tom later recounted to me, he actually went to the governor at that time, who was Mario Cuomo, the father of the present governor, and he said he wanted to switch sides. He agreed with the plaintiffs, not with the defendants in this case. And what was reported was Governor Cuomo said at the time, Tom, you're not getting out of this case if I don't. So he didn't switch sides. But what he did do is have his attorney call us and work out a deal. He did not want to be a named defendant in a case challenging the inequities in the state funding system for children. So we agreed to drop his name as a defendant. He agreed that the State Ed Department would cooperate, would let us have access to their files to get more information, which he did. So most of the information we got in that case really did come from Tom Sobel and everything he accomplished. But what I really wanted to tell you is how I got to know him, not as an adversary, but after he had resigned as commissioner and the years went by, litigation moved slowly, he no longer had any conflict, and he came to me and he offered to help with the case. And he actually became one of our prime witnesses. And he helped us define what is a sound basic education, which is the constitutional right that the courts have declared is the right of every child in New York State at the present time. But while we were preparing for the trial, it was really interesting. You know, you have to go through what's called a deposition, which is an opportunity for the lawyers on the other side to grill a potential witness and find out what they're going to say so they can be prepared for it. And Tom got very flustered at this deposition because lawyers play a lot of litigation games, and one of the issues in defining a sound basic education is what's a reasonable class size. So Tom was giving his opinion about what's a reasonable class size, and the lawyer said to him, well, are you familiar with all the literature on this? And he cited some 1957 study from Minnesota that said you didn't need a small class size. And he cited some other arcane studies in this area. And Tom hadn't been familiar with these things. And, you know, he got caught unawares. So the lawyer thought he had scored one. Well, when we were getting ready for the trial to actually prepare, I remember it was the night before we were going to testify. We were there till about 11 o'clock. We were going over all this literature, all these studies to make sure if they brought it up again, he'd be well prepared. And it's late at night. We're finishing up. And I said, by the way, Tom, I forgot to mention one other detail. I hope you won't mind this, but at the trial tomorrow, there's going to be a class of high school students that are going to come by to watch the trial, part of their civics lesson and all. And all of a sudden, his eyes lit up. And he said, there's going to be a class of students there. Why didn't you tell me to begin with? I don't care about these lawyers and all. It'll be like teaching a class. So he got a big smile on his face, and he told me he got a good night's sleep after that. And he came into the courtroom and came alive when he saw all these children sitting there. And when the lawyer started asking him all these questions about studies about class size, he just looked him in the eye and he said, you know, I've been an educator for 50 years. I was a teacher. I was a principal. I was an assistant superintendent. I was a superintendent, and I was a commissioner in the state of New York. In all that time, I never had a student, a parent, or a teacher come to me and say, I want a larger class size. And That did it. We didn't get into any of the technicalities. That was Tom. He beat the legal system. He helped us establish a wonderful right for a sound basic education for all kids in New York State. And for me, that is the legacy that I live with every day because of Tom Sobol. Thank you so much.
Who let the babies in? This is how I was greeted when I first began the inquiry program. I was young, I was a woman, an armchair quarterback was the closest I'd ever come to being an administrator. But somehow, where others were blinded by stereotypes, Professor Tom Sobol had a vision of potential. Although I had taken his ethics class, I was from New Jersey and didn't quite appreciate his reputation. I remember asking a classmate about it and being told, "Are you kidding? He's a legend." So how exactly does a legendary leader teach, you might wonder? Well, I'm not sure if he taught us or if he led us. His classes were less a lecture and more a curation of experiences. Each week we were introduced to name brand thinkers like Nell Noddings and Thomas Sergiovanni. We grappled with case studies that left us feeling conflicted and confused. At the time, I assumed that after an adequate amount of debate, Professor Sobol would weigh in, like Solomon, with some astonishing insight. He never did, and I felt cheated. I really wanted to know what he would have done with a teacher moonlighting as an exotic dancer to pay for her mother's cancer treatment. They were dilemmas, but I realize now that I would have been cheated by some cookbook response. They were dilemmas precisely because there was no tidy answer. And the true lesson was that each of us had to figure out how to chart our own course through the ambiguity and uncertainty of leadership by first finding and then refining our own moral compass. Like that course, the inquiry program was a curation of experiences. While I assumed that Teachers College would likely furnish me a network, I hadn't anticipated lifelong friends that felt more like family. It would be trite to call Professor Sobol the patriarch. Instead, he was more like a gravitational force, drawing students, professors, and national figures into his orbit. Somehow, when people found out that I knew him or that he was my dissertation advisor, they treated me a little bit differently. Nothing could push me harder to be a good ambassador for the Sobol solar system. When Professor Sobol gave written comments on papers, he didn't respond to your logic or your prose. Instead, his feedback cut right to the heart of who you were, who you would become, and the kind of leader you could be. At the end of the last paper I turned in were five simple words: whatever you do, keep writing. That faith in me and in my potential helped me begin to believe in myself and gave me the confidence to find my voice as an educator and as a leader. As we worked on my dissertation, I continued to meet with Professor Sobol regularly. During that time, I experienced a personal tragedy. As I sat in his office and explained what had happened, Professor Sobol's response was not one of the passive expressions of sympathy I had become accustomed to. Instead, he met me in that moment with genuine concern expressed as immediate action. He wanted to know if I had a place to stay, and in that moment, I believed he really would have taken me home to Harriet. It is an impulse that defined Professor Sobol as superintendent, as commissioner, and as a national leader. Not merely to opine, but to act. That moment and his imperative now define my approach when others share their own sorrows, and I strive not just to listen, but to act. We've all had those teachers who have encouraged us and inspired us along the way, but few among us can identify someone who literally changes your life's trajectory. Where others once saw babies, Professor Sobol saw leaders, and more importantly, made us see ourselves as leaders. Not by giving us answers, but by building our confidence and our own compass would guide us through the inevitable ambiguity so that we were ready, not just to analyze, but to act.
In a world in which superlatives are often overused, I think all of us would agree that Tom was probably the singular most remarkable educator most of us have ever known. And he loved that word. That's what he considered himself to be. I think the greatest compliment one can give an educator is that he or she mattered significantly in the lives of others. And boy, did Tom matter significantly in the lives of others. He taught us so many things, and he taught us in two big ways. One was through words, and you've heard some of them today, and you will hear more. The elegance and the eloquence of what he said and what he wrote. But the other way in which he taught us was who he was, how he conducted himself, what he cared about, and what he actually did day in and day out. He was, in many ways, for many of us, the mirror into which we gazed to see the very best that we could all be. I would like to share two lessons that Tom taught me, and I think taught probably all of us as well. One was that on every issue, there's a moral and ethical high ground. Tom's lesson was always, always, always identify that high ground, climb up onto it, put your stake in it, and never let anybody get you off of that into the mud. In Tom's entire career, I can't think of one time when somebody dragged him down from that high ground. The second lesson was everybody is important and everybody deserves to be dealt with in a civil and respectful way. Every one of us in this room, or almost every one of us in this room, has spoken with Tom one-on-one. And when we did, we all had the feeling that at that particular moment in time, we were the single most important person in Tom's world. Because at that particular time, we were each the single most important person in Tom's world. I will miss that mirror, and I will miss that feeling.
So Tom was the inspiration and the instigator of Public Schools for Tomorrow, an organization that came together with superintendents, people who were retired superintendents, and other educators. And we wanted to come up with a vision for where we thought education should be at a time when we were not very happy with what was going on. I gained such respect and admiration for Tom's passion about education, his incisive ability to get to the heart of an issue, his self-deprecating wit, his dislike of educational jargon, and understanding that you can't just be against reforms such as too much testing. You will attract allies only if you have a positive vision of what is possible and worth fighting for. I'm going to read from a small section of Public Schools for Tomorrow about teacher quality, which Tom wrote. Better student learning depends on better teaching. However, today's school reforms too often seem to assume that for some perverse reason, teachers and administrators know how to do a good job, but don't and won't. Too often, a guiding principle of policy seems to be that punishing or shaming them will improve their teaching. Some of the teachers may be the problem some of the time, but all of them are the solution all of the time. Research and experience show that you can regulate bad teaching out, but you can't regulate good teaching in, because good teaching is a product of hearts and minds of the teachers and principals who are involved. After reading Tom's wonderful book, I also gained an understanding of why he was such a champion of those who did not have access to power. When Tom recounted how he had to deal with his mother's leaving the family when he was 10, I understood that Tom's surviving this challenge created a deep understanding and empathy that he acted on throughout his life. My husband and I were struck repeatedly by Tom and Harriet's deep love for each other and lack of self-pity during the years that he was bedridden. Thank you, Harriet, for making it possible for friends and colleagues to be a continuing part of Tom's life during these years. We deeply appreciate it.
Tom and I became friends 54 years ago when we were both first-year teachers at Fox Lane High School. Tom was the head of English, and I was the teacher of business education. And we soon discovered that we had many students in common, which was a surprise to me because in those days, the department heads got to pick the two classes that they would teach, and almost universally, they picked the honors classes to teach. Tom didn't. Tom was teaching what in those days we called the non-regents classes, which were probably the least academically elite in Fox Lane High School. But he demonstrated to me a lesson that served me my entire professional career, and that was that we are teachers of children, we're not teachers of subjects. And he took a tremendous interest in the families of these students we had in common, even to the point of calling the homes, sometimes going to what in those days were called the projects in Mount Kisco, and helping the parents to understand how a completed high school education was going to be so meaningful for the lives of their children. And of course, he said it with such conviction because that was who he was. That was what brought him up out of Boston and into a position of influence in local school districts at the state level and nationally. A second thing that probably not many of you may know is that Tom was a gifted musician. Something that we had in common was not the giftedness. He was the gifted musician. But in that same year of our beginning teaching, Tom was the organist at the Episcopal Church in nearby Ridgefield, Connecticut. And I was the very interim organist at the Lutheran Church in Mount Kisco. And we shared that common interest. And a few years ago, when Tom recognized he wasn't going to be able to use his organ music any longer, he invited me to come to his house, and he wanted to give me his collection of music, which I welcomed. But of course, knowing Tom, just like with a book, Tom didn't just pack them up and put them in a carton and deliver the carton to me. We had to sit in his dining room, and we went over every single piece of music, and we talked about the registration, and it was in this measure that I added the flutes in, and all those organist kinds of things. And I, as I was thinking after Harriet asked if I would be willing to say something today, I was thinking back to that moment because he came to a Bach cantata, and he opened it and he said, "This is my absolute favorite." And it was his favorite, I'm sure, because of the difficulty and the challenge, particularly in the pedal board, of playing that Bach piece. But as I thought about what the lyricists had added to the words of that Bach cantata at a later time, I thought, isn't this really who Tom Sobol was? These are the words. "Sheep may safely graze and pasture where a shepherd guards them well. So the nation that is ruled in wisdom, in that the shepherd knows and shares many blessings with the sheep." And as I've thought about what Tom's career has meant in Newton, in Fox Lane, in Scarsdale, in Great Neck, in the state of New York, and literally across the country, he has been a shepherd who has made the nation safe because all of the people with whom he has worked are better off today because he lived and was among them. Thank you.
About 17 years ago, at a very difficult time in my life, I ate a lot of dinners at Tom and Harriet's kitchen table, some on 15 minutes' notice. Their hospitality was a lifesaver, and after dinner, Tom and I drank scotch and talked about stuff. One night, it was about how little we knew of the lives of our grandparents and how interesting it would be to know more. "Too late for that," I said, "but you can do something for your grandchildren if you'll produce an oral history. You talk, I'll record you and arrange for transcription." He agreed with the understanding that I would do mine the following year, and we swore an oath of silence about the project. Only Harriet knew, but largely left us alone in the kitchen. There were 15 hours of taping, and I think it took us about 3 or 4 months. When the typed transcriptions came back, I discovered to my amazement that they contained only perfect sentences and paragraphs. I rechecked the tapes. Indeed, there were no errs, no ahs, no uhs, no logical gaps. A certain amount of baloney, perhaps, and a few omissions, to be sure, but perfect paragraphs and soaring poetic language. A lot of history, a rich sense of both the times and the intellectual DNA that abounded in the Sobolevsky family. Tom was the literary character Patrick Dennis, and his Aunt March seemed to be his Auntie Mame, not in bizarre behavior, but in the way she exposed him to a wider world than might otherwise have been possible for this kid who lived in Roslindale, Mass., from age 7 through the years he took the trolley every day, first to Boston Latin School and then to Harvard. I think one of the things that bound me to Tom was our common experience of having commuted daily to college while living at home. There were wonderful stories about becoming an organist in an Episcopal church, a counterintelligence officer in Korea, and membership in the International Early Morning Paddle Tennis Association, known locally as INEPTA. By the way, the oath of silence about the taping didn't last long. Tom was so excited about the result, he told everyone who came by, and it ultimately became part of his memoir, My Life in School. What really excited him all his adult life, however, was being an educator, and he kept at it with incredible tenacity, even as his body failed. I remember a couple of perilous trips to Teachers College when he drove the wheelchair-equipped Chrysler van with the hand controls. He fought to maintain as much independence as he could for as long as he could, but driving with him was scary. He was an absolute charmer. For a few years, when he was still able to attend concerts and opera, I would get him to our seats and then take the wheelchair back up the aisle to get it stowed in a safe place. Inevitably, I would return to find him fully engaged with and delighting his seatmates, almost always women, of an age I then considered old. His last years, as his physical ability continued to decline, eventually with virtually nothing working but his brain, were an example both of his courage and Harriet's devotion, energy, and character. Together, they stayed in love, accomplished the extraordinary effort to complete and publish his memoir, and got through each day without apparent despair. Tom was my good friend. He dealt with his decline with courage, and he died gracefully. Thank you.
You all have been sitting very patiently. Why not stand and get the kinks out for a minute? Let's do it. Okay. I'm going to begin with a poem from Ezra Pound, four lines. And the days are not full enough, and the nights are not full enough, and life slips by like a field mouse, not shaking the grass. Contrarily, my brother Tom shook the grass. He shook the grass in all of us who come here to honor him, and in others who couldn't be here. And he left the footprints of his strength of spirit and his formidable intelligence etched forever in our memory. And we have loved him, and we say it aloud for all the world to hear. But if my brother Tom was here, as you've already been reminded, he would look at you and say, "It's nice to see some of you here." And he knew you would laugh, and he wanted you to laugh, because if you laughed, you might not notice something about him. There was a little boy in my brother Tom who never quite got over worrying that he wasn't good enough. And whatever he could do to overcome your impression of him so that you would not get to know him as he thought of himself as he really was, he would be safe. Like most of us, he was a splendidly complicated person. Now, I have known Tom since November 11, 1951. We used to call it Armistice Day. School was out for both of us, and we decided to take a walk. We lived in Roslindale, and some of you know Boston. We walked up through Hyde Park, Reedville, Canton, Dedham, East Dedham, West Roxbury, and back home. I drove it in my later years. It was 16 miles. But it was the walk. And Tom and I talked about it every time we got together for the last 60 years. On that day, we bonded. We became brothers. We shared things with each other that I, at least, have never shared with some of them, even my wife. We got to know each other. And I learned this about Tom. He had a patron saint to whom he paid annual homage. And the saint's name was Satchel Paige, who said, "Never look over your shoulder because they might be gaining." Tom drove himself to succeed. He spent most of his years trying to guarantee that no one would catch up to him. And for the most part, he succeeded, and he enjoyed the success that those things that success brought him. But one of the things was, as I've said, his relief that if you felt kindly towards him because of his achievements, you wouldn't see what he was really like. He wasn't really sure he was worthy. Now, I'm going to come back to that, but I want to share two stories about Tom that weren't in his book and are worth telling, in my opinion. The first is when Tom began his teaching career in Newton High School in Massachusetts. And as the new guy on the faculty, he was assigned to teach English literature to a non-college preparatory course. Kids whose focus was boys and girls and sports and dropping out of school as soon as they could. And at the same time, as you've heard, he was the organist and choir master at a local church. I was then in graduate school and for the fun of it, sometimes attended his choir rehearsal that he had on Friday night. I had a reason. I was dating a girl that was in the choir. But at a certain choir rehearsal, Tom passed out to us a copy of a very simple and plain old Methodist hymn that I'm sure came out of the prairies. Some of you will know the first line of it, "Blessed be the tie that binds." Well, we had to rehearse and sing that hymn. And then we had to rehearse it a second time because Tom had brought with him one of those suitcase tape recorders of the 1950s with the large double spools. And he wanted to tape it and get it just right, so we had to rehearse it again. And that he said, "That won't do." And then he went into his spiel. He talked about he wanted it sung like a prayer, like we were each touched to realize the incredible things that bind us, you know, as if we would be overcome in singing it and reach for the blessing of the very hand of God. If Milan Kundera had been born 20 years earlier, he would have had us sing so that those who heard it would unmistakably feel the unbearable lightness of being. You know, he was like that. And why all this fuss? Because the next day in class, the kids were reading Thornton Wilder's Our Town. Now, there's a scene in that wonderful play where the stage manager and I don't remember who else are speaking down front. And then they hear, coming through the open window of the nearby church, a choir rehearsing. You may know the play. Tom said that when he put that music on, as the kids were reading, originally they were startled and they stopped. But then they sort of listened and took a little more seriously the continuing of the lines that they were reciting. He said it was a serious moment. And maybe, you know, just maybe, he enabled one or two of those children, young people, to exercise their curiosity and stretch their imagination and suggest to them a depth and a mystery to life that is worth exploring. And oh yeah, one way to get there is through English literature. As you all have attested, he was a gifted teacher. There's one other vignette. It's shorter, thank heavens. Now he's in Scarsdale, and as he told it to me, there is evidently, or was then at least, an annual meeting of the citizens of Scarsdale, like a New England town meeting, something is what I think of it as, where the superintendent and the school committee has to present a budget for the coming year. And as Tom told me, there was a citizen of the town who every year became very well prepared about the content of that budget and was very critical of 800 things in it. And those 800 things he would lift and offer to the school committee and to the superintendent, and especially to the superintendent, who had to sit and take it all and didn't like that public criticism whatsoever. Well, the year came when that man, I don't know his name, I'll call him Charlie, he wasn't there, and he didn't show up at that meeting. So what did Tom do? The next day he called him, and he said, Charlie, we missed you. Everything okay? And Charlie told him, no, his wife was sick, and he thought he ought to stay with her. So the next year, one or two days before that town meeting, Tom called Charlie and said, are you coming to the meeting this year? And Charlie said, no, I can't. My back is bad and I can't drive at night anymore. And Tom said, well, have you seen the budget? And Charlie said, oh, yeah. And Tom said, well, listen, I'll pick you up. I'll pick you up and take you there to the meeting and I'll get you home, which he did. And Charlie did his thing at that meeting. And Tom did take him home afterwards. Tom brought him to his bedroom, took his socks off, helped him get into bed. And here's what Tom said to me about that occasion. That's probably the best thing I have ever done. Well, Tom was successful. He shook the grass. But in an incident like this, I think something of his leadership really shines. He never forgot for a minute where he came from. He came from a blue-collar family where money was scarce. Don't get me wrong, we were never hungry. We always had housing, and there were schools we could attend and libraries that we certainly used and ballparks we played in. But Tom was in college before we had a telephone. My family never owned a car. And my parents bought their first TV in the mid-60s. Well, Tom stayed in touch with all that. He never forgot that, the streetcar rides, the commuting, all of the above. And he rooted for the underdog, as someone has said, until at least he became a Yankee fan, which I never forgot him for, For he wanted everyone to have a chance. Everyone deserved a chance. And by God, he was going to do what he could do to see that they got it. Roots. Al Shanker, then the head of the teachers union in New York City, I believe, called Tom to congratulate him when he was appointed commissioner And Tom's immediate response was, "It beats working in the cold outside." Again, back to those roots and knowledge of what it was. Well, my last thought is my first. Despite everything, as I've known him, he wasn't sure that anyone could really love him for who he was. He received esteem, praise, congratulations for his successful career, but he wasn't sure. And then came Harriet. Now, Tom and Harriet have been married, or were married, for more than 40 years. Well, it didn't happen overnight, but over the years, I believe Tom came to realize that Harriet loved him. Slowly, Tom began to relax. She became the lifeline, his lifeline. And it was a lifeline to a place of peace that he had never known. Now, how do I know that? I know it because when I would visit him when he was ill, there would be those occasions when Harriet would come in the room and kiss him on the forehead and say, "Tom, I've got to run some errands. I'll be back soon." That was fine. And Tom would fall off in half sleep. 5 minutes would pass, and he'd wake up, and he would say, "Has Harriet come home yet?" And I would try and tease him, and I'd say, "No, she got in a streetcar and lost her fare, and maybe she'll never return. She will never return, you know." And he would smile and nod off again. 5 minutes later, he would say, "Is Harriet back yet?" And I'm beginning to realize now that that was a serious question for him. For Harriet really was the one who kept Tom connected and feeling okay. As long as he could be with her, he could relax. Some of you may have wondered, suicide out of the question, why anyone would choose to live those years he lived so terribly disabled, terribly dysfunctional. And I believe the answer is that Tom could finally stop running. He wanted instead to enjoy the peace that he was enfolded in and wanted to enjoy it for as long as he could. And for that, Harriet is to be thanked, and I thank her. I conclude. Several years ago, my daughter, Suzanne, sent me Henry James' words at the death of his brother, William. They're better than any words I can find. "I sit heavily stricken and in darkness, for from far back in dimmest childhood, he had been my ideal elder brother. And I still, through all the years, saw in him, even as a small, timorous boy, my protector, my backer, my authority, and my pride. His extinction changes the face of life for me. Besides the mere missing of his inexhaustible company, his personality, his originality, and the whole unspeakably vivid, beautiful presence of him. So, Tom, I miss you. Tom, I thank you. And Tom, I love you. Thank you."
Good morning. I have some notes of my own, and then I'd like to read a letter that my father wrote me. Where are my kids? A simple six-word declaratory sentence uttered to me the moment I entered adulthood at age 14 has comforted, inspired, and at times angered me over all those years. When in 1972 my dad spoke this most important sentence of my life to me, a decade both idyllic and wrought with turmoil was over. I had known my dad as a young man. My first memory, watching him from the Revere Beach boardwalk as he finished his swim, stepped onto his flatly laid out towel and assured himself that no single grain of sand would reattach itself to him as he donned his black ankle socks before his white sneakers. He was physically agile, able, and quick. In the spring, he would pitch a mean curveball to me or toss a tennis ball up so far in the air that my brother and I would scramble in the backyard to see which of us could catch it. And if we did, big hurrahs, and if not, do it again. In the fall, on many Sundays, upon his return from playing the church organ, I would hold our ladder as he climbed up onto the roof of our split-level house so he could point the antenna of our black-and-white TV towards Hartford to pick up Channel 3. More to the left. No, more to the... Wait, right there. Wait, okay, right there. Why did we do this? We did this so that we, along with the other neighborhood men, each arriving with a six-pack of beer in a brown paper bag, would be able to get a snowy signal to watch an otherwise blacked out, pathetic New York Giants home game loss. And of course, I would remind him to take the pliers off of the roof because they also were our TV remote control. Back then, to me, my dad could leap tall buildings in a single bound. But those years in rolling fields were cracked with a growing, untreated cancer. My parents married too early, each then unequipped by their own upbringing for either marriage or parenthood. My dad's understandable anger, his frustration, his loneliness could get the better of him. It infected his ability to enjoy life, to pursue the destiny of what surely would be an extraordinary career. My family, our family, we were like the 1960s. Innocent and happy, yet riddled with conflict and having a need to shed something big. The marriage had to be put down. And so when my dad pulled up my desk chair in the small attic bedroom of our unkempt Scarsdale home in 1972 to deliver to me, one-to-one, the official news that he was leaving, I sat on my trumpet case and I braced myself. I don't remember most of what he said. He did right to make it quick. He probably said all the right things about still loving us, supporting mom, how it isn't your fault. But then he prepped me for the thing he wanted me to know most, the thing he always wanted me to remember, and he said that six-word sentence. I will always be your father. Now, I knew the statement was meant to be profound, but what on earth did he mean by, I will always be your father? Now, sometimes it felt like a dare, a so there, but that couldn't be what he meant. The biologic fact was self-evident, so that wasn't it. Nor could he have meant that he would always be around. That would be untrue, and I have no memory of my father ever speaking untruths to me. And we both somehow knew anyway that we were headed toward the classic cats in the cradle relationship. Sometimes what it did mean was that while he wouldn't be around like other guys' dads might be, I could still know I had a dad. That helped, sort of. Other times I saw it as his proclamation that that was something that couldn't be taken from him. Now I liked that one because that meant that I was wanted. But over the years, none of these explanations really landed. He must have meant something else. Like a stubborn man refusing to take directions when clearly lost, it never even occurred to me to ask him what he meant. But I have long figured it out on my own. I will always be your father means that I am connected to something quite important, something quite grand. I've always felt that. Just being Tom Sobel's son, nothing more, has been enough for me and for him to give me. He taught me, just by him being him, what it means to be a Sobol. I went, oh yes, that's spelled S-O-B-O-L. It's not hard. But before I tell you what it means to be a Sobol, what the ness is in Sobol-ness, know this. Each of you, since you are here, have some Sobol in you. Some of you bear the Sobol name, by blood or by marriage. And for those of you who have the Sobol name, hear this. It comes with a hefty responsibility. Others of you are parts of the Sobol family or Sobol friends, Sobol mentees, or maybe a Sobol for the day. But we all share in different measure and are commanded to follow the three principles of life my father gifted me just by him being himself. First, you must lead, and lead through hard work. My dad became a great leader, not by birthright, or money, or luck. Of course, he was blessed with an off-the-chart intellect, but my dad worked his ass off to succeed. Work has intrinsic value, but work must enable honest leadership through setting the right example, not coercion. Second, you must put your social conscience to work, even if it comes at sacrifice to yourself or your family. My dad worked in public education his whole life. He championed equitable funding for poor school districts, multicultural education, the right of local decision making. As a child, I recall him standing by the rights of a gay school teacher. He did that 45 years ago, despite the venom bitten into him by many in the community just because it seemed weak of him to support someone who is disenfranchised. He took that and other criticism very hard, but he did not waver. He never made any real money, though he could have done lots of things in his life. Third and finally, every once in a while, you've got a tilt at a windmill or two. Great accomplishments don't emerge from low aspirations. My dad tilted at windmills. His policies were at times pie in the sky, but they were always the right thing to do. And that's just the thing. A Sobol might tilt at a windmill or two, but we tilt true north. So there you have it, the Sobol commandments, the ness in Sobolness, leadership through hard work, social conscience in action, and tilting true north at the occasional windmill or two. So there, unlike my father, for whom these attributes were second nature, the rest of us can only inspire them, to embody them, but we must. And on those occasions when we do, we feel most Sobol. I am proud to be a Sobol. So what can I say now to my dad, now that he has passed? I know what. Dad, I love you. Dad, I miss you. And know this, I will always be your son. It took me a little bit of time, so I'm going to hold off on the letter.
Thank you, Tommy. I'm Michael Sobol, Tom Sobel's son. My dad called me Mike. Wednesday, October 24th, I think 1979. Dear Mike, herewith the note to say that there is no news. I am working and playing paddle. Harriet is teaching and charging around and nagging Jeffrey. Jenny is working as a student director in a production of Anne Frank. The Pope has gone home, inflation continues, and the oil companies seem to be doing very well. So, if you were to ask me the inevitable question, I would respond, York, Brunswick, Caledonia, like that. So much of my dad's life was a public life. We've heard so much about it today. And in that way, I think many people in this room knew my father better than I, not only because you were integral to his life's work, but because it was so integral to him and such a big part of him. But as his son, I was lucky and fortunate to be there when engaging purposefully dropped off, when irony and humor would kick in, and when you took life a little less seriously in order to appreciate it. Sunday, September 28th, 1980. Hi, Mike. Sunday night at the ranch. I finished my work for tomorrow. I'm upstairs where I watch, sort of, Carl Sagan's Cosmos. Harriet just came up. She's reading the Sunday paper and turning the pages with excessively loud, crisp, tearing noises. So, as you can see, the weeks go by, but not much changes. Except, of course, in the long run, then everything changes. Now, I must have been working on a school assignment and written to my father about it, and I went right to the expert to get his advice. But ever the teacher, of course, he doesn't hand me the answer. Instead, he gently nudges me towards it. To answer your recent question regarding child abuse in the classroom and the methods whereby teachers are to retain control of their charges, most of the studies that I have read tend to support the premise that the most effective stratagem is your basic swift kick to the groin. Preferably administered with a steel ski boot. Such a gesture is all but certain to secure the attention of the most recalcitrant pupil, particularly the male of the species. He then drops his kidding tone and says, "What I really know to be true is that in the good teachers' classrooms, the question never arises." My dad had what he would call the capacity for the poetry of experience. Now, he never said this about himself, but he said it about me sometimes, and I know he said it about others, and you know, to the extent that I would have that at all, it would really just be, came from him and be something of a reflection from him. But he described the poetry of experience as the knack of seeing within and beyond the surfaces to the essence of events, to the extraordinary in the commonplace, the tears at the edge of joy, and the echo of the past in the contemporary noise. He continues in this letter and he writes, "On Friday, I went to a meeting in the administration building at Fox Lane, my old high school in Bedford, New York. It was beautiful weather, clear, high, blue light, and the leaves were beginning to turn. It still must be the most beautiful sight for a public school that I know. What did seem funny was to be on such familiar turf with such essentially unchanged surroundings and yet to have so little connection to the people who are there now. I kept seeing the ghosts of the kids and teachers I used to know. Then I thought of playing touch football in the middle school shelter with Mr. Telfer. I wondered if you ever thought about the place. Weird day. It reminds me of a day, a very special day that I had with my dad many years ago. I was a young teen, maybe even a little bit younger, and it took place in the A&P parking lot below his apartment building on Old Mamaroneck Road in White Plains, a place that he had for a short period of time after my parents separated. I had spent the night, and it was morning, and we were rushing off to wherever we were going, I don't recall, but rushing for sure, and to this car, which was in the A&P parking lot, I'm pretty sure by agreement. A gust of wind came up, and I don't know who did it first, but one of us reached for the leaf that was falling from the tree. And of course, as soon as you reach out, the wind pushes the leaf away, and we couldn't catch the leaf. And if you knew my dad at this period of time, as many of you did, you know, what naturally ensues at this moment is an athletic competition of sorts. And we spent the morning, what seemed like a real luxury of time, waiting for the gusts of wind and the leaves to fall, running around the parking lot, darting and lunging, and missing the leaves or catching them. All sorts of rule-making ensued. We kept score. We played play-by-play, and we played the announcer, and we did the cheering and the booing and the crowd noise, and what quickly was just a momentary thing became an extended morning of chasing leaves around the A&P parking lot. Just one more. And, one more turned into one more set, which turned into a tiebreaker. We didn't want it to end. Decades later, my dad would write me about that particular day. We hadn't exchanged thoughts on it in the interim. But he said that even in that moment, we knew we were trying to catch a time we couldn't hold. I'm grateful for those times with my dad, the off-schedule times. And so many of you have said so many words of gratitude towards my father. I asked him about this once, about the feeling of indebtedness that has to what a parent gives you, and maybe it applies to many of you and what you're feeling towards the contribution that he made in your life. And he writes, May 28th, 1983, number 4, "You say generously that you hope someday you can repay me for what I've given you. You can, and I hope you will, but not in the way that you think. The way children repay their parents, when they do, is by giving them their own children. Love, says Harriet, trickles down the generations. I write a check to Hobart, grumbling, and in my memory, I see my father slumped on his elbows at the dinner table, the oilcloth scrunched up and coffee in the saucer, half drunk and sleeping, home from another day of stacking beer barrels onto trucks. But he is home. Our house is safe. My world continues. I help keep your world safe because I love you and I loved him. Well, wanted to, but that's another story. I seem to be wandering. The point is this. If you have children, be good to them. If you don't have children, be good to other children. That is the repayment humanity requires." Mike, I remember common reactions to changes of weather, season, and place. Common tears. My arms around you when Harriet and I were married. Tossing the old tennis ball in the back and forth on the couch. Watching some dumb TV program together. And more and more. One grows beyond these things. One even forgets them. But at some deep unspoken core of our being, they remain. He writes at a very specific moment in my life, but I think his words are eternal. So tomorrow you will graduate and you will enter a larger life that extends far beyond Mount Kisco and Huntington and Scarsdale and Bedford, far beyond me. But always in some way the first leaf falls or the sky first turns dark towards winter, something you cannot name will remind you that you once felt loved. See ya. Love, Dad.
Good morning, everyone. We're all here to memorialize Tom, not eulogize Tom. I say this because a eulogy is delivered when somebody dies. Tom is far from dead. The vehicle that carried Tom is gone, but the cargo, which is the real Tom, is present and has been embedded in so many curriculums, publications, and institutions. His life continues. Some of the people involved in my son's education were students of Tom, so it's being passed on to him through them full circle. I am very fortunate. I work for Scarsdale Schools, where Tom left his mark. Such a special place because of him. When I walk the halls, enter offices and classrooms, I can feel him. He lives on there. He is forever a part of the district. When people find out that I'm Tom's stepson, they light up. I've been told by his students that he's changed their lives, giving them the confidence to pursue their roles in education. I've been told that he was a rock star of education, and that after classes, at classes, teachers, college, students would wait in line for a chance to interact with Tom. Tom has a gift of making people believe in themselves. As Mark Twain said, keep away from people who will try and belittle your ambitions. Small people always do that. But the really great make you feel that you too can become great. We all have a physical being, but that's not what makes us us. It is short-lived and very fragile in the scheme of things. The cargo is what we carry that makes us us. He was a student, a scholar, a spy, a church organist, a musician, a teacher, a superintendent, a commissioner, a professor, a mentor, husband, father, stepfather, grandfather, athlete, author, and so much more. Even with his extensive Ivy League education and incredible intelligence, he never made others feel less for not knowing what he did. Tom and I shared the same sense of humor. Often it was just him laughing at my less than appropriate jokes. I miss his tremendous and wonderfully infectious laugh. I am one that was blessed by divorce. I was given so much by the separation of my biological parents. My sisters Leslie and Leah would not exist. Leslie's children, Hannah, Ava, and Wyatt would not exist. And I assure you, the world is a better place with them. I never would have had the relationship with my step-siblings, Tommy, Michael, and Sandy. I have great memories of the time we spent together. I never would have the relationship with Tom, which has a strong hand in making me the man I am today. I carry a lot of Tom into the future, as does my son, Colin, my wife, Wanda, my sister, Jennifer, her husband, Dennis, and their son, Dashiell. As all does you present here today, and so many more. My education from Tom was different. Our classroom was a dinner table, rides in the car, family trips to Cape, Nantucket, Sacandaga, and many other places. I feel so fortunate for having this close relationship to Tom. Tom cherished life, even when life didn't cherish him. A brilliant mind trapped in a body that was failing him. He had such a strong love for life and education, family, never giving up right to the end. As most of you know, he typed his last book with one finger. I saw what true love was. He loved my mother so much, as did she him. We learned how love was so much more than just physical. Harriet stayed by him until the end and never would have given up on him. All of you can help give Tom the eternal life. When you use some of the cargo that was given to you by Tom, tell the people that you passed it on to where it came from. Now, as Tom would say, now go out and do some good.
Maybe everybody else needs a big, great big breath. I don't know what I'm supposed to say at this point. Not much, don't worry. Before I say another word, I do want to thank you once again, President Susan Fuhrman, your generous invitation to remember Tom in this beautiful, warm building. And thank you to Jim Gardner for introducing us to your combination fairy godmother and magician, the woman who brought joy into my heart during the worst days of my life, Trish McNichols. Get it right, yes. You made it all happen. For you, it seems everything is possible. I'm aware that there are wonderful, skilled people I haven't had the pleasure of meeting who perform magic behind the scenes. I thank them as well. Thank you, Dr. Carl Weber, Manuel Velasquez, Avril Gordon, and Angela Carter. You gave Tom the respect, quality care, laughter, your company while he cheered the Yankees on and watched debates and elections. You helped him to live longer and better than anyone thought possible. Thank you also to my brother Donald Kay, who nightly heard my upset and calmed me with his medical knowledge. And now a question for the audience. How many of you were Tom's students? Could you stand up? Do you mind? You know, do you have any idea how much he loved you? Sometimes when I was waiting for him to tell me he loved me, he said, I love my students. You should know this. He was happy in your presence, whether talking to you about your life in his office or working with you in the classroom. I believe one of the saddest days of his life was the day he realized he could no longer teach. In his memoir, he wrote, I felt the wheel had come full circle, and I was back where I belonged, engaging with students and exercising both my mind and theirs on matters of importance. How many of you are working in schools as teachers, principals, or superintendents? Oh, come on, more. Okay. I ask you this because before we watch the videotape, I'd like to read you two brief passages Tom wrote about teaching in his memoir, My Life in School. Quote, some people discover that they have the gift of singing, dancing, acting, healing, or making money. You didn't have that. I discovered that I had the gift of teaching. As I used it, I came alive, and it became who I am. A page later, he wrote, as Alfred North Whitehead said, good teaching is religious. I use the term in its most liberal connotations. Transmitting human culture to another generation is a sacrament. Helping young people grow into the full power of their humanity is a sacred duty. The video you will see in a minute is the end of our program. It seems appropriate that Tom will have the last word. The video is of a speech he gave at a celebration when he was leaving Scarsdale years ago to go to Albany. The first section is about Scarsdale. We cut it to make the video shorter. I would be remiss not to say how proud I am of my children, even though Jenny did not speak. I'm still proud of her. And my stepchildren. There was clearly a bond between them and their father. And Sandy didn't speak, but she did write something on the program. And I'm just very proud of their love and their understanding of their father. I might add that if Tom knew all this was going on, he would shudder. The truth was, he was the most modest man I've ever met, and he was definitely among the bravest. Thank you for being such a caring audience, and thank you all for your letters, mails, emails, and phone calls. They made me weep, because that's what I do when words touch the piece of me that is deep inside and hidden from the world. Thank you all. As Tom would say, you only have one life. Go out and do good. And after the videotape, there's nothing else except your friends and people sitting next to you. Thank you.
And now I go to something else. As you know, I've been entrusted with a large and exciting professional opportunity. I don't yet know what it'll be possible to accomplish, but I am certain about what the agenda must be. It is to improve the education and the lives of thousands and thousands of poor children in our state, children who are growing up ignorant and incompetent and alienated and unhappy and often angry. In the weeks preceding and following my appointment, I have spent much time visiting schools elsewhere, chiefly in New York City because it's there, East Harlem, the South Bronx, Bedford-Stuyvesant, the Lower East Side, but also in the rural areas of upstate New York. And I have seen schools that are working and schools that are not working. But in general, what I have seen, none of you would tolerate for so much as a few days. I have seen a school where a principal apologized to me because she runs candy sales to raise money to buy paper for the children to write on. Apologized because she knew that most of the parents who buy the candy are on welfare and can't afford it. I have seen a school where 18 children and a teacher were meeting to conduct classes in a crumbling boys' laboratory designed for six boys at a time. I've seen a high school where the dropout rate exceeds 50%, and 16 security guards equipped with nightsticks and radios are not enough to help the staff keep order. And as I listen to the people in those schools, and as I feel their frustration and their anger and their pain and their yearning for something better, I know what it is we have to do. We have to make it possible for the parents of the children in these schools to have what Scarsdale parents want for their children in the Scarsdale schools. A safe, nurturing environment, a sense of community, opportunities to learn, a chance for a decent life. And we don't need to lose what we have here, but we do have to change the current course of history for thousands upon thousands of these children before they are consigned to bleak futures in their own lives and join a growing underclass which undermines us all. Not to take action on these matters is both morally wrong and politically stupid. In ways I cannot yet predict, I shall be calling upon you for your help. Again, not only to do good, but to act in your own enlightened self-interest. What you may not know is that this is not a new mission for me, but a chance to close a circle. When I was a boy in the city of Boston, I would ride the elevated trains and stare at the back porches of the rotting three-deckers that lined the tracks, the laundry dripping from frayed and crowded clotheslines. Later, as a junior and senior high school student delivering papers and visiting friends, I would pass the derelicts in the streets and climb the stairs and hallways smelling of urine and boiled cabbage, and feel the presence of too many people in too few rooms. And year after year, throughout my boyhood and adolescence, I would vow that someday I would do something about this squalor. But I didn't. I came into my young adulthood at a time when America was moving to the suburbs. So when I became a teacher, I moved there too, out to the Garden City of Newton, where the jobs were, and where, frankly, I too and my children could have a yard and a garden and live the good life. And so it went from suburb to suburb until I landed in this lovely village, which has become our home. And I don't regret that experience, not for a minute. But now, it is time to pay something back, to try at least to do something for those less fortunate. So I leave you, determined out of my whole life's experience, to make the most of this wonderful opportunity which has been given me. I am grateful to you for what you have taught me, and if you pardon my saying so, I am very proud of who, with your help, I have become. But I don't trust my own words to end these remarks, so let me close instead with a favorite passage from my great friend, Mark Twain. Now it is time to go. But I cannot let you go without telling you something that is on my heart. You know, I cannot always be cheerful, and I cannot always be chaffing. I must sometimes lay the cap and bells aside and recognize that I am of the human race. And I want to tell you that I have received in this past year, since my 70th birthday, hundreds of letters from all conditions of people, men, women, and children, and there is compliment, praise, and above all, and better than all, there is in them a note of affection. Praise as well, compliment as well, but affection. That is the last and final and most precious reward that any man can win, whether by character or achievement, and I am very grateful to have that reward. Many and many a year ago, I gathered an incident from Dana's 2 years before the mast. It was like this. There was a presumptuous little self-important skipper of a coasting sloop engaged in the dried apple and kitchen furniture trade, and he was always hailing every ship that came in sight. He did it just to hear himself talk and to air his small grandeur. One day, a majestic Indiaman came plowing by with course on course of canvas towering into the sky, her decks and yards swarming with sailors, her hull burdened to the plimsoll line with a rich freightage of precious spices, lading the breezes with gracious and mysterious odors of the Orient. It was a noble spectacle. Of course, the little skipper popped into the shrouds and squeaked out a hail. Ship ahoy! What ship is that? And whence and whither? In a deep and thunderous bass, the answer came back through the speaking trumpet. The Begum of Bengal, 142 days out from Canton, homeward bound. What ship is that? Well, it just crushed the poor little creature's vanity flat, and he squeaked back most humbly, only the Mary Ann, 14 hours out from Boston, bound for Kittery Point, nothing in particular. Oh, what an eloquent word, that only, to express the depths of his humbleness. Now that is just my case. During just 1 hour in the 24, not more, I pause and reflect in the stillness of the night with the echoes of your affection still lingering in my ears, and then I am humble. Then I am properly meek, and for that little while, I am only the Mary Ann, 14 hours out, cargoed with vegetables and tinware. But during all the 23 hours, my vain self-complacency rides high on the white crest of your approval. And then I am a stately Indiaman, plowing the great seas under a cloud of canvas and laden with the kindest words that have ever been vouchsafed to any wandering alien in this world, I think. Then I am the Begum of Bengal, 142 days out from Canton, homeward bound. Good night.